It's early on Monday morning.
It was one of those
the best
jams,
I could do. We've both been very ill over the weekend.
Yeah, it's not been a good weekend. It's not been a good week, really. There's been a lot of...
A lot of that sort of gastric kind of flu-y thing going around. But that's enough of that.
Say no more.
Say no more.
Say no. There's a video coming out about that and our journey through...
It's called Life at Both Ends. Hey.
So.
Hey.
Hey, Lee. What's up?
I'm not too bad.
Happy
man.
Monday.
How are you? Happy Monday.
Yeah.
Squeezing my lemon or something.
Squeezing my lemon.
I don't know. There's a lot of guitars, aren't there, with three single coils on them?
Yeah.
These
or
days.
Or just in that specific shape.
That vein.
That vein of the guitar that you're holding, which is the, of course, the iconic Fender Stratocaster.
Yes. The guitar that changed everything. Changed everything.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, Fender Stratocaster originally came out in 1954. The one I'm holding is from the Fender original series. It's more based on one of the 60s guitars where the rosewood necks came in. But basically, it's from the original series. So it's kind of like it's classic, old school classic.
Yeah.
We've got five other guitars, which... Well, four and a half. Not very stratty, this one. Five other guitars that are trying to do their thing. Two of which even have a connection to Leo Fender himself.
Let's see if you hold that for a minute.
I will hold this.
I'll put this away, because this doesn't have connections to...
Not directly.
Not directly. But...
This beautiful green machine here, called a Cutlass.
Yeah, that is...
This, I believe, was one of the designs that Leo Fender was messing with during his little window that he worked with the guys at Music Man back in the sort of mid to late 70s. Obviously, we've got here an HSS, we mean humbucker, two single coil version, but I believe it's available in three single coils.
Yeah, it is, yeah, absolutely. 100%.
So we're going to little jimmy around on that one.
Yeah. And then we've got the Skyhawk.
Not we
the,
have.
Not the Silver Skyhawk, the Skyhawk.
Just the regular original Skyhawk.
Yeah. Which again was the next step, wasn't it?
Yeah, that was another Leo Fender thing at G&L from, I think, 1984, which has just recently been reissued. And so we'll cover that a little bit as
May I just quickly add, really quickly.
Yes.
When you look from that to this.
Yeah.
But these two guitars have got more in similar... When I'm looking at it, the bowing on the top of the scratch plate.
It's this bit here freaks me out. So if the Fender does this, and the Music Man and the G&L does, you know, goes the other way,
yeah.
And it changes the whole look of the guitar.
The whole look
of
the guitar. And also the two top shapes of the horns are much, much more similar on this guitar than they are on that guitar.
This is like a skinny version of that one, isn't it?
Actually, you know what? Because that's got the armrest on it, from the Strat, and this doesn't it's more rounded, the whole thing, but I believe if we hold these two up to each other, I think that these two guitars are actually very similar in size.
Are they? No, it's definitely skinnier. It looks like it comes in a little bit.
I don't think it is, man. I think absolutely very anyway, these two got
why has that got a battery in it?
It's because they got a silent circuit in there.
I see.
It's not active or anything, it's just a
That was the Skyhawk.
Yeah.
Then we take a bit of a leap into the 2010s. So we jump forward about 40 years, with in no particular order. Probably the Paloma was probably the oldest of the next three.
Yeah, I think
this is
so,
like
yeah.
a 2 or 3 year old design.
Yeah,
right?
Something like that. Yeah.
I'm not even entirely sure why this made this into the pick, other than it's very pretty and it was here.
And it's a double cut and it's got the three...
Is that a double cut? I suppose so. So this is in. Then, again, most of you will be unfamiliar with these. This is kind of an example of what you would get if you went to like a very small boutique builder. This is a guy that we've been dealing with for about a year now called Grey Guitars. He builds guitars out of London. This is his Emperor model. Again, you've got quite a lot of options, you know, as you will get with custom built stuff, you know, quite a lot of options that you can choose on that.
Yeah.
We've
got the Silver Sky.
The Silver Sky.
The PRS Silver Sky John Mayer signature model.
Yes, the guitar that John Mayer collaborated with Paul E. Smith to try and make to give him something. I think in his own words, that was it just to be a bit more consistent maybe than some of the Strats that he'd
played. Yeah, I think just he wanted more consistent. He wanted something that with, I don't know if I'm going to say faults, but the things that he didn't really like about Fender that he thought should have been upgraded in the design of the Strat.
Let's do the G chord challenge.
Then
we'll cut this together so that all you hear is like, everything. So we'll leave all the settings the same on the amp. This is Hot Rod Deluxe, so it's real standard stuff. No pedals.
No pedals on at all.
All in the same tuning, all same constant tuning, pitch tuning, all the neck pickup.
Neck pickup. So let's see what this does, okay? So you get them all in one go. Here we go. G chord. Skyhawk. Well,
might need to do that again to try and remember, but my sort of takeaways from that one, which one did you try first?
This one first.
This one?
Yeah. Very full. I thought it was very full. It has loads of top ends and loads of bottom end.
Do it again we'll have it again. Because the other thing that's interesting is, some of these guitars are very full at the beginning, and then although the sustain all goes on for a long time, it's like lots and then like that. And others are more
and others natural. And others keeps the Paloma had the low end just kept the low end kept rolling
the
in.
The G&L was the loudest one, definitely the loudest one.
That was the brightest one.
Yeah, I thought so too.
And I thought the music round was going to be the brightest one, but it's not.
Yeah, I thought the music round was quite mid range. Yeah. But let's try this again. Let's do the G chord challenge again. Okay, here we go again. We'll talk about it afterwards this time.
Okay. G chord again.
Yeah. So that's a nice, what I would call a linear sustain. So it's not getting like quickly quiet. It's just gradually getting quieter in a nice, even way.
And your strum, my strum sort of over, starting from the middle pickup and down sort of towards the front pickup. And this is the sound of it. It's nice top end, nice low end, and it keeps going. Mm. So that all of the tone keeps going in and as the sustain goes.
What do you think of the tremolo system on that?
Tremolo system, because it's set up like this with a four, it's very hard.
Very stiff,
it's
it?
Not a... Yeah. Right. You know, John likes his bridge to be set to
the body.
It's
quite a traditional six screw kind of, you know, with the folded metal saddles and everything. It's quite a traditional style trem system, isn't it?
But it's, you know, it's got this, there's something extra done with it, so it... It does feel so, better. I'm sure you could put that up to...
great technical explanation there, Pete.
Yeah, they've done something extra to it.
It's really useful.
No, because it's a different block.
It's because it's
the back.
Black. You mean it's got a black block in
yeah,
the back?
Yeah, it sounds better.
Sounds darker.
And then,
I get it.
No, it's got three screws here, and this bit, apparently, the way that it do that...
I like to do that. Well, it's got three screws on the Fender one. It's just basically a Fender rip-off tremolo system. Is that what we're saying?
Say that, yeah. Okay. Anyway, it was a very technical explanation.
It was.
You're welcome, Okay, so next we did the Skyhawk.
Did we? No, I think we did the green one next.
We did the green one next, did we? Okay. Well.
Well, we are now.
We are now, and we could just cut it, so we did the green one next.
No, it's fine.
Okay.
So you got only one tone control now, and we got the,
one
the
tone
dual
control.
Fulcrum tremolo system now, haven't we?
Yeah, and it's... it's beautiful.
Much softer.
Much softer. And that's... Anyway, we'll talk about it in a minute. So, here we go. The G-chord challenge.
Is it just me, or did that... It would seem to have a more pronounced upper mid-range, and it seemed that it got quieter quicker. So the overall sustain seems just as long, but it's like quite loud, and then it's... Yeah, the guitar doesn't do that, does it, really?
The guitar doesn't do that. It's got a mighty fine sustain on its own.
Mighty fine.
Which I'm very surprised. Yeah. It's got a massive sustain in it.
Just making it up now. I don't know. It didn't sound as...
it's not got the same...
Stratty.
It doesn't sound as right. It doesn't have the same low end to it, which is
like
just
chimey tone.
Yeah, and when we did the intro there, I just went immediately. I backed off on the tone control because I felt like when I did that it was a bit pokey. But not listening to them,
let's
it was
keep
not,
going. And then I think what we'll do after the G chord challenge is we'll play a bit of lead stuff on each one and kind of go. We'll talk about how does the neck feel and all that kind
tremolo
of stuff.
Tremolo system,
great.
It's really lovely.
Totally agree.
With the two point on it.
I would say that with the exception of the Grey guitar, where I love the tremolo system on that, typically I prefer this
two-point
style
tremolo.
Of the two-point
tremolo. I'm in both
in
ways.
Both camps.
Both camps on that one. But that is a very special tremolo. Mm. We'll talk about that in a minute. So, Skyhawk. Skyhawk. Hawk from
Hawk.
The sky. G chord. Much louder.
Much louder.
But the low end keeps going longer.
Yeah. I mean, that will absolutely be the pickup designs in those. Those MFD pickups are kind of like hot.
Have you ever taken MFD?
Coils. I made a kitchen out of some.
Oh, you did? Okay.
Yeah. Hotter pickups, but not sharp hotter. I mean, they're fuller, aren't they? And a bit louder.
Fullerton.
Fullerton. Fuller tone.
Actually, I'm fuller tone. Yeah.
The Skyhawk has the expander switch from the S500 series, which we'll talk about in a bit, but we've got it switched off for the time being, so that it's just the straightforward neck pickup.
Sounds good.
Sounds good.
It sounds good. It's got more of the low end going on.
I think we... Did we do this one next or this one?
We did the Palumas. Hey! Right, so again. Can you hear there's a little bit of a rumble?
Yeah, and sometimes people criticise the sort of the Bigsby-style trem systems in the sense of, you know, maybe not having quite the same sustain as the traditional-style trem systems. But
that's rubbish.
Is it?
Yeah, I think that's rubbish.
Nobody ever said that. I just made it up.
It's almost got a piazzo quality to the...
Do you think so?
It's almost like it sounds a bit more hollow than it is.
Maybe, yeah.
But maybe that's to do
with
this.
I agree with... I think it's that there is a distinctly less mid-range on that. A bit more like the Skyhawk, I thought.
Yeah, and it's got when the low ring... Have a listen to that low end and see if you can hear it out there in the internet land.
Oh, like... It's got like a drone note going... Oh, like a bagpipe.
It's almost like a... going on underneath... thing.
This is so technical, this video.
Yeah, that's the technical term. But so what makes one of these guitars so different, even though... Oh.
Pardon you.
Pardon my chair. Right, Mr. Gray. Hey, hey. I'll give it another go.
Yeah. They've all got a weird drone note in there, haven't they?
Now this not so much. Not the
not
blow
much.
More.
Yeah.
Keeps going with the. I mean, these are bright pickups.
Well, no, they're not. So that originally had the bare knuckle 63s in it.
Yeah.
And they sounded so bright. I asked Tom to change them. So we've now put a set of the bare knuckle old guard boot camp pickups in there, which are not as bright, but they're still coming out bright. So I'm going to conclude. Obviously, tone wood, you know, debate rages on.
Oh, here we go.
This guitar was made out of oak, which I've never, ever had a guitar made or even heard another guitar made out of that timber before. And I'm going to put it out there that I think that is just a bright sounding timber.
Oh, we need to do that. We need to test, take the same pickups.
Yeah, because that's there's two different sets of pickups now gone in that guitar and they've both come out bright. So,
yeah. But is it worth trying to take another guitar and put it?
Is it worth taking?
Take my blue Strat.
Mm.
Stick a pair of the same bootcamp pickups in there, or just one in the front, and do the G chord challenge again.
Or we just get a flamethrower and we literally just ignite this debate.
Oh,
full on.
Yeah, exactly. Because anyway. This is, I mean, okay. So last but not least.
Last but not least, of course. Last but least,
the one that started it all. The iconic. Stratomicaster. More like that.
I mean, we can't really say that this one sounds anything other than a Strat because obviously it is one. But it's not as bright as I thought it might be, and it definitely seems to be fuller in the mid-range. So again, it's maybe not even... It's funny how you perhaps have perceptions of what a Strat should sound like, and you play other guitars and you think, oh yeah, that's really Stratty, and then when you try the Strat you go, oh, I don't know, maybe it's not. But anyway,
can I do something really quick, because I think I've got a sort of feeling that this sounds more like that.
Really? Yeah no,
I just want to quickly
agree,
which is really weird because it shouldn't on paper.
I think the intonation is better on the Paloma.
Well, that's another discussion.
Yeah.
Maybe not. Maybe it's got a little bit more low end, but it's damn close, isn't it?
Really close.
Right. It's really close.
So let's talk about the necks and stuff. So we'll hand the guitars to each other, play a little bit and just go, what is it? So we might as well start with the Fender, as that is.
That's a Dane. I mean, it's a Strat. It sounds like a Strat wood.
I'll just play through your amps.
Yeah.
Bigger neck on this, isn't it?
Bigger neck.
It's not like a modern American sort of professional series. It's also got the lacquered back, which obviously is something else that on a lot of modern guitars kind of got removed. And certainly on nitro finish, you know, old nitro finish guitars, by the time they're, you know, 30 years old or whatever, all that's worn off.
Yeah. This has got nitro though. Now again, they do nitro
on
next,
the original
so this will wear
series,
off.
That's right.
Yeah, it feels like a...
Yeah, I'm sort of like...
Like a Strat?
Meh.
Yeah. So this is more interesting now, because this is definitely probably the neck that is most different to all the other ones.
It's definitely brighter.
See, it's definitely brighter, right?
They're all the same scale length, these, aren't they?
Yeah.
They're all 25 24. And a half.
Yeah, 25. Yeah. Dane? It's brighter. It's much brighter. And the neck is so different from any of these other guitars, 100%. Yeah.
So it's thinner this way, as in thinner this way.
Yeah.
It's narrower this way. And it's got the thing that I know Pete always says it doesn't make a difference to him, but to me it does. It doesn't have the rolled edged fingerboard. So it's I don't find it has that sort of lived in kind of feel. The intonation on this is just great, though.
It is, yeah.
It's still quite stiff, the trem system.
I tightened it a little bit.
I think I've put it slightly out of tune as well.
I tightened it a bit. But the neck always on these, because it's a satin neck. I mean, look at the neck. Can you get the...
Yeah, you wouldn't necessarily always get that crazy flame on these, would you? But that's
the roasted ones.
Are they all like that?
Yeah, this roasted series are like this. And it's just, it's smooth, isn't it?
I really like that smoothness.
And it takes a little while to get used to, because of the...
Just out of interest, I think the Fender is... £1,500 or £1,600. This is about 24. Okay.
Something like that. Yeah. This is a special colour, so you won't, unless you custom order this colour.
Yes, that's so a special Danish Pete colour.
Yeah. But it's gorgeous. But they all look great on
this. One is about £1,600. These are all American. Sorry, they're not all American made. These are German and these are British, but the other three are American made. Four. One, two, three, four.
Yeah.
Four.
Okay, so this guy, the neck is much more similar immediately, apart from the rosewood, to the Fender. Goes wider down here. Not rolled edges either, or is it? Slightly?
Slightly, yeah, I would say slightly.
Much,
but more than the Music Man.
Yeah, I think if you rolled the neck, the edges on that, it would just feel too, the neck would be too slim. But let's see. These are set up on a Plec machine as well, by the way.
It sounds almost like a P90 or something at the bridge, doesn't it? It's really fat sounding.
Yeah, it's very fat. I like it, I really like it. The Dane. What's the... This is 10, is it?
I knew you were about to ask me that. Do you know, I'll have to look.
I think it's 10
or 12. The only one I know 100% is the PRS is 7 1/4.
Yeah.
The Fender, I'm pretty sure, and I'm not even entirely sure how...
9 1/2. That's a compound.
That is 9 1/2, is it? No, it's not compound.
Is it not?
No, not in the original series.
Okay.
Probably.
9 1/2 then. I think this is 10 or 12.
Yeah, this is flatter as well.
Yeah, 10 or 12. He does 10 or 12. This is the compound, I think.
Right, okay.
I think. I think, ten, no, it's 10.
I think this is just 9 1/2. I don't think it's compound.
No, I think it is.
Well, we'll have to go and check that spec on Tinterweb.
Sounds great, man.
Let me try. I would say this feels similarly wide to the Fender, but a smidgen narrower, sort of back to front than the Fender.
Like a modern.
A little bit more modern feeling. Yeah. It looks like it's got jumbo frets on it as well.
I think so.
Yeah, the expander thing, by the way, is just gives you a couple of extra sounds. So you've got, in this position, it's these two pickups here. And in this position, it's all three. So, interesting. So yeah. this is kind of just the neck pickup. And then you've got neck and bridge. And then you've got all three if you want. A little bit like Fender's S1 switching on their Elite Strats. What's the trem system like? I like it. I don't like on trem systems is, and some of you all know what I mean here, I don't like it when there's any play between the actual trem arm and the trem block, and pretty much all the Fenders that I've got,
because it's screwing and yeah, there's, the, end of little...
the, there's like a micro of a millimeter kind of gap, yeah. So you get this like it's indiscernible. It just doesn't feel like it's kind of one of the reasons why I quite like the Bigsby style tremolos, because it kind of can't do that. It's almost the least stratty sounding of them all.
Yeah.
Because it's just fat. It's like, so it feels Fendry.
More like, but those pickup makes it sounds like a different guitar.
It's like a fat Fender, but in a good way, plus size.
Fender.
It's like a plus size Fender.
Okay, moving swiftly on.
That one next?
Yeah. Neck again feels very, it's much slimmer that way here, but it feels the same width and it goes up the same way as the Strat does.
Yeah.
So that feels exactly. Strings are a little bit too low for my liking, actually. I might take them up. See what I mean?
Yeah. So I think of the
It sounds very stratty.
It's slim this way, very similar this way to the only one really that's noticeably narrow is the Music Man one, I think. Yeah, the action's a bit too low on this, isn't it? Yeah. Is this the one that you can retrofit, or is that different? It is. This is.
Yeah. It's the arm and the spring is all the same, so that you can retrofit that on any Gibson. Because
I don't think it's exactly the same. It's very, very similar. There's a Duesenberg trem system that you can retrofit to any Gibson.
Less trem two, it's called.
Less trem,
like Les Paul.
Do you know that? I mean, I like everything about this guitar. I just don't know if I like the frying pan type.
Oh, frying pan, that's a good one.
I mean, it looks cool, but is it? Or maybe I do. It's very... I just
and
worry that I would...
it's a four-way.
What one's missing,
It's
though?
Okay when it's in a four-way.
What's missing out of the five positions?
See, I'm not quite sure what happens.
Not those two?
See, that's full back pickup, right?
Yeah, I think that what's missing is these two together.
Yeah.
That's that one.
Yeah.
See, that's those two, isn't it?
Yeah, but it sounds a bit out of phase-y.
If only we knew someone that works in a guitar shop that could tell us. I totally agree.
It's a lovely guitar.
It's the most un-Strat-y of all the things that we've put in our Strat lineup, but it's absolutely fantastic.
And it's Duesenberg's. It's Duesenberg's. Yeah, and these Strat, isn't it?
This will be one of the. I mean, the reason we picked these guitars is they're all roughly-ish in that sort of £1,500 to £2,500 bracket, and the Paloma is certainly sub 2,000. I forget exactly where it is.
1,700.
But that's awesome. I like that a lot.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's always surprising when you put it up against.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not a trim system that you would.
I wonder if it could be if you just took one of the springs off and set it up differently.
Take a spring out and float it. I mean, or you could just unscrew these for a little bit, you know, Bosch.
Yeah.
So, neck.
Wide.
It's quite wide down here. It is slim. Actually, it's very similar to that.
Is it?
When I'm sort of holding my hand around it. It's a much more curved fretboard because it's 7¼, ain't it?
Yeah.
So you would expect the action is slightly higher, but you would expect it to. It's not fretting out, which is interesting.
Yeah.
So that's cool. Let's get some Dane on top of John. I think he needs one of these pedals, doesn't he?
He does. He stolen that, have you?
Yeah, stolen it from the guy who did this guitar. Who's this guitarist?
Oh, really?
Yeah, some just on Instagram like me.
That sounds great.
And then he's there playing this riff.
It's ugly as sin headstock, but
That's where we disagree. I really like this guitar. I like the headstock. I don't think it's ugly. I think it works really well.
And if you're ever stuck on a desert island and can't open a tin, you've got.
Look. Okay, I agree.
There's nothing wrong with any, apart from this one. I totally agree. The other one is this one looks like someone's charging at you with a spear. I'll give you that one as well.
I like the headstock, but again, it's one of these. This is like fits your hand.
That's like a treble clef, I think. It's just like at a musical note or a pregnant lady being cut out the side there. Look, there's the baby bump, there's the boobies.
And there's the boobies.
Yeah.
I like this. That's a nice
design. The
4-2
is a classic design.
And that
one,
of course,
you can't. And of course,
it's classic. But I don't like that.
I should just say, I believe that what Tom has done is actually, Tom Gray, on more recent Gray guitars, he's made the headstock a bit fatter and a bit less like a dangerous
spear-throwing
object.
I do agree, these could have been nicer.
Different colours.
Pearl.
Let me try.
Maybe.
Let me try.
But I really like this guitar. I'm going to keep saying that because I think it's a great guitar.
So you should.
Yeah.
It's huge, this neck.
It is much
bigger. It's a big neck.
It's a much bigger neck.
It's a big neck, and it's got a really thin, like, laminate. Well, no, it's not a laminate. It's a slab.
Slab board, isn't it?
A slab board, but it's very thin at the sides. It looks like one of the laminate ones. But
I tell you what, John, if you are watching this, I'll swap you a Dane for one of those and a massive bear hug.
I like that it's been voiced around a really classic, like my favourite sounding Fender, like lots of bass end, lots of treble, not too much mid-range. I like that. Put the Dane back on, I like the. It's not my favourite feeling one, but I guess that's subjective, isn't it? But it's certainly a great sound.
Neck. It's a big neck.
See, that's what I don't like. See, that.
No, but
it's not doing
for
anything.
Me,
I've
for
got
me,
to go for it harder.
No. I on my Strat, I don't think I've ever had the. Now you on this.
You got this one to go.
Oh,
haven't you?
Okay, yeah. Right, there we go. So the neck on this is almost as narrow as the...
It's a much more contemporary feeling, yeah, that one, isn't it?
And it goes up and it becomes a bit wider down there. Now, I'm not so keen on the way that I almost feel like the neck on this goes...
More V-shaped.
It's more... The whole thing is V-shaped. It doesn't go straight on. It goes whoop. You know, the whole thing. And then it's rounded a bit.
Yeah.
But this feels much more like the Music Man.
Yeah.
Because also it's got... The Music Man has got a slight... Asymmetrical?
Asymmetrical, yeah. Asymmetrical.
Cool. So that it fits with this bit of your hand.
Okay.
So the neck is carved like higher and lower. This one feels a little bit like that.
Yeah.
Lovely.
Yeah.
It's spotter. It is like this. These two guitars feel really, really similar.
Yeah.
They really do. Like,
I think a lot of it is when we fall in love with relics guitars from Fender.
It's almost
nearly literally did Zulu me. when we talk about why we love the feel of relic guitars so much, it's because once that lacquer's gone on the back of the neck and it's bent. I mean,
yeah.
This was a bit of a project guitar for Tom. We'd had this idea of making a range of guitars made from indigenous British timbers. So it's got an English ash neck, a plum tree fingerboard, and the oak was out of some reclaimed wood from my house. The normal version of this would have, I think it's a sycamore body from memory.
Oh, yeah.
But
it's
not. So it will be a little bit different sounding and perhaps a little bit different weight. But the neck... It's very contemporary.
Yeah.
So it's thin this way. It's not too wide here.
It's almost like a V. It's got this V.
And
it's the same as this.
I'm picking this up a lot.
Yes, but feel it's the same.
It's the back of the neck. It's got gun oil or something, isn't it, on the back of the neck?
Yeah,
just to give it
there's something.
Sort of...
But the necks feel very similar, these two guitars. Who doesn't like ass and plums?
Wow.
Well, so now we've gone through them all, Lee.
Yes.
Haven't we? We did this in the beginning, didn't we? So which one is your favourite?
It's really hard, isn't it? I mean, genuinely, I think I probably do like this one to play the best.
Yeah. I've got a similar with that or the Music Man neck. Did you pick it up, you go, oh, that's really nice. But there's a feeling about this and that together.
These two are very similar.
They're very similar.
In everything, sound, feel.
The necks, and, you know, they're both lacquered necks.
Yeah. I really liked, you know what though? I think it would be, I would say, it's really odd this one because... The three that I'm kind of leaning more towards are almost the three least traditional ones. So I like this one, and this one.
Yeah.
I like this, definitely like this. I like
pickups
this for the tremolo
awesome.
System, and I like it for the pickup system.
Yeah.
I really do.
Yeah.
I'd like to try one of these with the rosewood boards.
Yeah, it's not rosewood, it's something else that is, because they don't
is
use
it not
rosewood.
Caribbean rosewood.
Is that what it is?
Which is not a part of the rosewood family. Or it's not covered by the Cycles.
Yeah.
So no. I like this for the sound. This I just like. I like this again for the trem system. I like the sound. I like the feel of this one. And I like the feel of this one a lot.
Yeah.
But there's an element of kind of... I suppose there's an element. You know, there's perhaps a sentimental attachment to this one. There isn't really one that I don't like. I kind of think that for me... Again, on these two guitars, I suppose to a certain extent, I didn't feel it so much on this one. I don't know why. And I didn't really feel it much on this one. But I think I'd want to get...
Take the lacquer off.
Some of the lacquer off.
Yeah,
the back of the neck
that's why these. That's why these two,
yeah.
When you pick them up the first time and you feel them, there's definitely
so,
a wow factor.
So I don't really know. I mean, visually speaking, visually speaking, I mean, what's not to like?
It's classic.
The Fender Strat. I mean, there isn't really one that I think out of all of them, the one that I probably have struggled the most to like is the green. Just the body shape of it.
The body shape is the same as that, I'm telling you.
Yeah, I don't think it is.
Okay, we have to measure it up.
I don't like the headstock on this. Sorry, everybody. But you know that.
No, exactly. I mean...
What was your favourite?
I'm not sure. I mean, I really like the PRS, which is just out of the... It sounds like a more fatter Strat.
Yeah.
You know, where this is a bit thin. Neck is really nice. This neck is awesome. It doesn't sound like a Strat. Yeah.
I was surprised with this.
I think
if we'd have thrown a custom shop Strat in and we'd have bumped the budget up and had, you know, because the custom shop stuff that Pete and I spent are like 3,500 to 4,000 quid. And we were like, should we put one of those in? And we were like, no, we'll put the original series in because it's way closer to the price of all these.
Yeah.
I think if we'd have thrown one of those in, we'd have just gone, that's still the daddy.
Yeah. That's very interesting to me, that though. I like it. I still want to measure this bit to there, from there to
we'll
there.
Go, all right, well, we'll go and do that then.
Because those two look so similar.
It's very cool. I think, yeah, this one, there's some, I like that there's a blue one in with a rosewood neck in this range, which I like the look of.
Sunburst one with the rosewood neck looks really good.
But most importantly, before we jam out, I think we should just jam out with another tremendous loop of some sort.
Yeah.
And then you decide, what did you like the best? And in these kind of shootouty type things, why don't you list in the comment section below four or five guitars that you think, oh, they're kind of all similar and I'd like to hear those in this type
good
of...
Good shout.
And we'll try and do that in the future.
Yeah, and we'll just do the G chord challenge.
The G chord challenge. Gonna trademark that. Thank you. Do that at the end.